What's up, everybody? This is Francis over here from PlayerEssence.com, and welcome to this mega Player Essence Cross Nintendo. And we have a massive show for you guys today. I'm pretty sure I'm going to have an editing nightmare after this show, but we're going to get it all in. The first thing that I want to say is I want to say thank you from the bottom of my heart to all of the Player Essence fans, the community. You guys are the best. I don't care what anybody else says about you guys. You guys are awesome. You guys have shown your dedication. You guys have shown your support for me and helping me out and helping my site out. And therefore, I try to do the best for you guys, trying to update the site all the time and trying to make sure that I do what I say. Although I don't always do everything when I say I'm going to, but I try to get it up. So I just want to say thank you. I really appreciate the support. And I put up a question. I was like, hey, you know, I'm going to make this show. I need you guys' questions. And within an hour, I think I had like 50 questions already or something like that. And it ballooned all the way up to, as of right now, to 107. And that doesn't even count the people on YouTube and Facebook and all of that stuff. But I'm going to be answering mainly the people on Player Essence's questions. I have a ton of stuff to go through. So I said I was going to do news and some other stuff, but we don't got time for that. What we got time for is these questions, the main topics, which is going to also be big, and my announcement that I'm going to be making at the end of the show. So without further ado, sorry for no Nintendo news desk. I'll probably do another show very early in the week, next week, just to get that going. But let's go ahead and let's get right into the main questions here, because I know you guys want me to talk about that stuff. So let's see here. The first question is from NBR. Who do you think will win this console war, considering the strongest system has never won? Now, this is probably the weirdest console war we're going to see, or, you know, this fake console war, because it's not real. It's really not real. But this is a weird one. Who do I think is going to win? I have no clue. If I was just to guess before all of this stuff with the PS4 was happening, I would say the PS4 is going to win. But now that this is happening and Nintendo has some pretty good, you know, exclusives lined up, I would say it's between Nintendo and Sony. Microsoft, to me, isn't really in the picture because they don't have Japan. I really think you can't win a console war without Japan. I mean, Nintendo sold 12 million Wii U's in Japan, more than 12 million. PS3 sold over, they're getting up to 10 million. Without having that extra 10 plus million to count on, I'm not going to bet on a system that is $500 at launch, has the bad PR, but there's still people who think the DRM is in there. And, you know, it's really expensive all around, you know, for Microsoft. And then with all these games coming out with these $20 passes and then $60 controllers, everything is just jacking up the price. So I don't think Microsoft is going to win this console generation, if you're going to, you know, say who's going to win. It's between Sony and Nintendo. The thing is, I think the shelf life for these two systems is completely different. I think Nintendo is hard at work at their next system, and they will be unveiling it probably in 4 years or so. I really think that we're going to get a system in, you know, 4 to 5 years, whereas Sony's not going to show off their next system for God knows who knows how long, maybe 8-9 years. So I think there's going to be a definite gap. If you want to talk about the short term, I'm thinking Nintendo, but in the long term, I think Sony is probably going to sell the most PS4s. So, there's the answer. Gameroid24, do you think third parties will ever be fully on board with the Wii U? Well, at least UB, Activision, etc. But do you see EA or Bethesda coming back? Do you think Xbox One will be Microsoft's last console if it doesn't make a profit? Okay, so for your first question, do I think third parties will ever be fully on board with the Wii U? No, I don't think third parties will ever be fully on board with the Wii U. And there's many other people that are, you know, that are asking this type of question. No, I don't think so. Just mainly there's a lot of reasons why. There was one video by Nintendo that he did, Sony, Microsoft, and Nintendo have you in the palms of their hands. And it talks about why Nintendo doesn't have the third party support. And really, to make a really long story short, the reason why Nintendo doesn't play the game, Nintendo doesn't play by the rules of the industry. And the rules of the industry are, you know, pay for DLC, for exclusive DLC, pay for advertising time on TV, help these third-party companies get filthy rich, while you are broke, which is Sony and Microsoft. While you're broke and you're not making anything, these Western third-party companies want them to be, want handouts. And even some of the Japanese companies, they want handouts here and there. Hey, you want something from us? You know, give us something. For the most part, that's how it is. Now, it's not for every single one, but that's how it is. And Nintendo, it will have none of that. Now, Nintendo has no problem giving you money if you're going to do something exclusive. Like, for instance, like Bayonetta 2, that's going to be exclusive. They have no problem doing that. Working with Sega to get Sonic Lost World, exclusive. You know, they have no problem with that. But they're not going to sit here and hand out money for one extra Assassin's Creed mission pack. You know, that's ridiculous. They're not going to hand out money for TV, you know, advertisement saying, hey, well, this is on the Xbox. You know, when you watch TV and you see Assassin's Creed commercial, it makes it look like it's only on PlayStation. You know, Sony pays for that. Nintendo's not going to do that. And Nintendo doesn't play the rules of the game by Bethesda and by, you know, EA and a lot of these people. They don't play the rules, so therefore they don't get the third-party support. Now, there's more to it, and that's not all, you know, I'm not saying that's the only reason, but I suggest watching that. But just long story short, no, I don't think Nintendo's ever going to have full third-party support on board, unless one of the manufacturers, I guess, goes under next generation or something like that. Who knows? But no, they won't have full third-party support. Okay, and for the next part of your question, do you think the Xbox will be Microsoft's last console if it doesn't make a profit? Yes. If they don't make a profit and if they're not successful in it, if they continue to hide billions of dollars within Android patents, the next president's going to spin off the Xbox division and sell it to somebody else and all of that. Yeah, so they better, if they don't make a profit, yeah, it will be their last, or it will be sold to someone else, or something bad's going to happen, basically. All right, next question is from Sevenson. Nintendo did a Nintendo Direct for the 3DS games next year. Do you think they will make one for the Wii U at the end of the year? And what do you expect them to show? I think that there will be a Nintendo Direct fairly soon. I'll say a big Nintendo Direct, maybe December, because there's nothing planned for December other than Wii Fit U, the bundles for Wii Fit U, the package bundles. There's really nothing planned for December. So I definitely think there's going to be some type of Nintendo Direct either December or early January, like they did this year, to show off like Monolith Soft X and Shin Megami Tensei Cross Fire. There's going to be some big Nintendo Direct after the holiday rush to get people excited about the 2014 lineup. So yeah, I can see that happening. Let's see here. And what do I expect them to show? I expect them to show more information on Smash Bros. I expect them to show more information on Shin Megami Tensei Cross Fire Emblem, because we need to know about that game. All the games that they've shown off a little bit for 2014, Bayonetta, I expect them to show more of that. And I expect them to reveal, I'm thinking they're going to reveal either Retro's next game. Well, no, not Retro's next game, because they have Donkey Kong. I'm thinking they're going to reveal Mistwalker's next game, because Mistwalker is working on a Wii U game. They're not working on any games for Sony and Microsoft systems. They're not working on any games for the 3DS. They are working on a Wii U game, and they pretty much alluded to that. So I think Nintendo's probably going to show off their next game, just like they did in January with Monolith Soft X, where they showed off that game. So I think it'll be ready by then. All right. Good question. Next one is from Kalo, or Kaloe2. Do you think third parties will be burned by ignoring the Wii U with the PS4's faulty hardware coming to light, possibly faulty Xbox One in addition to slow adoption of their $400 and $500 price tags? Yeah, I think that, yeah, third parties will definitely be burned by not supporting the Wii U, especially not supporting it properly, because you saw it launch. A lot of people were excited. You know, the games, like, for instance, like Zombie U, despite not being that good of a game, that great of a game, it's okay. You know, it's not bad. I have the game. I like it. It's okay. But it lacks a lot of features that you see in other, you know, games. And that still sold 500,000 copies. You know, that still sold a lot. You look at Monster Hunter, you look at Lego City, these games are selling, you know, upward of 500,000 on, you know, system that at that time barely had 3.5, you know, install base as far as millions of users. So I think that they're going to be burned, because if you can release like a port of something and it can sell, you know, 500,000 copies, that's a lot of money in your pocket for a port that doesn't really cost a lot. So yeah, I think they're going to be burned. they're going to be burned because there's going to be a slow adoption rate. But they have a backup plan, and their backup plan is to release games on the PS3 and Xbox 360. So it's a lot of third parties are thinking, oh, well, even if the game doesn't do well on the Xbox One, we still have our PS3 and 360 version to make money off of. So that's what they're thinking. They're thinking they don't need Nintendo right now. A lot of, I mean, some third parties, of course, are, but a lot of third parties are just thinking we don't need them right now. But they'll be burned maybe future down the line, especially if the Xbox One and PS4 doesn't pick up, like, let's say, into next year or the year after. Third parties are going to scramble, they're going to panic, and they're going to throw everything they got at the Xbox One and PS4. In the meantime, they could have been really in putting some of those games on the Wii U and making some money. So yeah, they'll be burned, but in their minds, they won't be. Kid King 17 asks, how much more can games actually improve or evolve? Games can be larger, better AI, more NPCs on screen, but what else can be improved? So yes, three questions. I'm going to answer that one right now. Games got to be improved from an intellectual standpoint. Games need to be improved from a functionality standpoint. I think better controls can always be put into games. I think that's going to be the natural evolution of games other than just graphics. Because as we've seen, you know, with this generation coming in, you know, while the graphics are better for some of these games, yet they still have the same problems, you know, like with Killzone and Knack, they still have the same problems that these games have as far as this generation. So I think the natural evolution needs to be more of ideas, creative thinking, better controls, rather than, you know, more NPCs on screen that do nothing. You know, like, for instance, like Dead Rising, it's like, that's great. Dead Rising has 20,000 zombies on screen, but are you going to be fighting 20,000 zombies? No. You know, are you going to be doing it? No, you're not. So, I mean, I think developers need to really worry more about mechanics and controls, because a lot of these games just feel clunky. They don't feel that great that I've been playing lately. They need to focus on more inventive, creative ideas rather than putting more NPCs on screen, rather than, you know, saying, oh, our AI is the best, because that's what the developers of Killzone said, and Killzone Shadowfall does not have that great of AI. So, yeah. Here's his next question. Do you want one of the big three to drop out of the console business? No, I don't wish bad things on anybody, but the way that this next generation is going, I'm not sure if I'd mind if one of them did drop out. Now, Valve is coming in, so four major console manufacturers hasn't been around for a while now, and you know, it might push somebody out, and it's not going to be Nintendo. That's all I got to say. So, and his third question, what games do you predict are going to be announced in 2014? So, I think we're going to see Metroid. I think we're going to see Bethesda's next Fallout. I think we're going to maybe see even a Skyrim or some type of Elder Scrolls game announced. I think we're going to see some reboots of some classic franchises from Nintendo. I think we're going to see Star Fox. I think, of course, like I said, Metroid. I think we're going to see some type of F-Zero. I think we're going to get a lot of classic game announcements, plus new game announcements from people, of course, new IPs. But lots of good stuff's probably going to come. All right. Tom asks, what's with all the problems I've been hearing about the PS4, from faulty HDMI ports to overheating? It's true. A lot of people are not happy with their PS4s right now. There's been a lot of problems. There's been overheating. There's been issues. There's been mass damage control from sites like IGN. Even editors from drone sites have been trying to damage control for Sony, but you can't stop it now. And if you go to the Amazon page, you're starting to see a lot of people complain, give one-star reviews, verified purchasers saying that their PS4s are brick, don't work, overheat after a couple hours. And the reason why this happened, now I don't post his videos on here because there's a lot of cursing in them, but if you ever watched The Best of Both Worlds on YouTube from Drone Crusher and Fat Gamer, they called this 100% in their last Best of Both Worlds. They said that the system's rushed. Fat Gamer said that the system's rushed, that both Microsoft and Sony messed up because these systems are rushed. They're going to be messing up. They're going to be having problems. And he called it 100%. These systems are rushed. Now, we don't know 100% about the Xbox One right now. Okay, so the Xbox One isn't out yet. We don't know if that's going to have problems or not. Knowing Microsoft's track record, you never know. But he called it. And these systems are rushed. They probably could have waited another year, but developers were getting, third-party companies were getting upset and all that. So, yeah. So that's the reason why you're having all these problems, because these consoles are rushed to the market. And let's see, I think he has another one. He says, the new Smash Bros. Looks cool, but what do people mean by keeping the competitive edge? Last I checked, wave dashing was an exploit in Melee. People want the competitive, because I'm not really sure what people talk about that. I know some people have made videos saying that it needs to be more of a competitive fighter, no tripping. I think that's one of the biggest things that people, you know, don't want in there, which I think everybody doesn't want tripping in. Sakurai already said no tripping's in the game. So I think just things like that, people talk about the competitive edge. I'm not really sure. Maybe making the game a little bit quicker, like how Melee was, but I'm not really sure about that. And I think his last question, Tom's last question, what do you think about the potential gaming drop for the Xbox One and PS4? Okay, this is actually one of my main topics that I'm going to get to, so we'll talk about that in a little bit. All right, next question is from Maestro, who's a very active user on the site. Man, what's up? Even though Nintendo and their first, second party make a lot of great games that bring all kind of gamers all around, but a lot of them are far easily fooled by mature games and oversaturated genre shooter in this case, and third party who doesn't want to develop on the Wii U. Do you think Nintendo needs to develop some games, not to cause a detriment to their games, to fool the audiences and kind of stop with the false image of kiddie Nintendo and actually bring them over? I see what you're saying with all this. And yeah, it's a lot of the new age gamers who have this kiddie mentality. Archimedes123 made a fantastic video on this. If you go on my search site on the website Player Essence, look up Archimedes or look him up on YouTube and look at his videos. Look at the video titled Kiddie versus Mature. Mature versus Kiddie. And he breaks this down far better than I would ever be able to break this down. But to answer this, Nintendo need to counter to that as far as to bring over. I think that maybe they need to, maybe they can maybe publish more games that have that image or put their name behind games that have that image. For instance, like Bayonetta 2, you know, that can be something that really kind of gets the attention of these gamers. But I don't think they should ever lose their essence, and I don't think they should start developing first-person shooters. Maybe that fad will pass over at some point. At one point, everybody was making platformers. At one point, everybody was making fighters, you know. So maybe this shooter fad will pass over someday. Who knows? But, yeah, I don't think Nintendo should ever do that. But I definitely think they can get behind a little bit more. Or they can kind of make more of the tween games. Like, for instance, like Fire Emblem. I think when people see the Shin Megami Cross Fire Emblem, you know, when people see Bayonetta 2, and people see the next Zelda, I think people are going to start saying, okay, Nintendo can be a little bit more, you know, mature with their games. So, we'll see. All right, and he has one more question. Do you think the experience of developers will be noticeable? Noticeable if they've got an easy environment. Or they need to know limitation? I mean limitation in the sense of where developers can't do what it wants. Oh, okay, I see what you're saying. Before going to powerful. Okay, so basically what he's saying is that do developers need to be shown like limits and be able to work around those in order to make better games? And you know what? I think to a degree, yes. I think developers who, if you really want to try as hard as you can on Wii U, you know, I think that there's certain walls that you might hit, but if you can do some cool things or some creative things, it really forces you to think. Now, if you have the most powerful system and you can just dump everything on there, you're not gonna try hard to optimize. You're just gonna dump everything on there, you know. I remember them saying that at one point, like Killzone Shadowfall is like 200 something gigabytes, you know, and what are they spending so much time on that for? How is it 200 something gigabytes in space? I mean, and I know they brought it back. They brought it down, you know, to, I think it's, I don't know, 40 or 50. But still, it's like, that's just a colossal waste of time. They should be developing better AI and better mechanics and better, you know, different gameplay stuff and more than three classes in their multiplayer. So, I mean, you know, I see what you're saying. And yeah, I definitely think having some type of limits can help developers make better games. I mean, look at the people who develop on the 3DS. They really, to be successful in 3DS, you really have to think and you really have to pull out all the stops and you really have to focus on gameplay. That's why Fire Emblem Awakening is so great. That's why the 3DS has so many great games. And that's why Nintendo has so many great games on the 3DS, is because the developers really just focus in and hone in on what's going to be important in the game as far as gameplay goes, rather than just worrying about graphics or being able to just dump everything on there because you have, you know, 50 gigabytes of RAM or whatever, you know. So, yeah, I see what you're saying there. All right, next question comes from Matthew Wesley. What do you think about the critical ratings of Knack? And how do you think Sony created this failure of a game and why? What do I think about the critical ratings of Knack? I already knew it was going to be bad because Sony the studio that they had create the game, they didn't make that great of a game, you know, beforehand. That the Japan studio, the people who made this game, they're not very good. They made Folklore, they made some other games. They're not very good. They're just not a very good studio. But, you know, because Sony forces them to make games that they don't know how to make. They force them to make American style games, and I think they all grew up playing Japanese style games. And I think Mark Cerny being the lead on that, I think he was stretched a little thin because he's the lead architect of the PlayStation 4. Plus, he's he's the director of this Knack game, and I think that his mind was going back and forth, and he's being really stressed about all sorts of stuff about talking about the PS4 and all this junk. And I think Knack was just a rushed game with very shallow mechanics and not even that great of controls or gameplay. I just think that it was just a rush game, and the people who are making these games, the Japan studio, I don't think they even want to make games like that. I think they want to make like RPGs, and they want to make like good old school platformers, and I think they want to make games that they grew up playing, because these guys are all Japanese. They didn't grow up playing, you know, American style beat 'em up American style with, you know, the voice acting that Knack is in, and they didn't, like, in games like Folklore, they didn't grow up playing games like that. They grew up playing the old school, like, Japanese style games, and I wish Sony would let them make games that they want to make instead of forcing them to make these type of games that focus on other things other than gameplay. So, I mean, I think that's why. I think Japan Studio, I think they're good developers. I just think that they're in the wrong area. I think that Sony needs to let them make a game that they want to make, not something that they want to make, you know, that Sony wants them to make. So, yeah. How do you think Sony created a failure of this game and why? Well, I explained why. All right, Kid King 17. Nintendo isn't getting a lot of third-party support. Why is that? Is Nintendo really blame-free, or all the third parties really in it to destroy Nintendo? Well, I talked about it a little bit before, so you guys already heard me talk about that. Is Nintendo blame-free? No, they're not blame-free. Nintendo has done certain things to not get third-party support here and there. It's all over the place. Dr. Trey made a video about it saying that Nintendo canceled a lot of games, like, that used to be like the old, like the Rockstar North. They canceled a lot of games that were coming out for the N64, and the people at the Rockstar, they got mad because they keep on getting their games canceled. Nintendo has done other things as far as system architecture-wise that maybe developers don't like. Nintendo didn't jump on board with online early enough, like with the GameCube. That should have had online capabilities. The Wii should have had better online. So, I mean, even like WiiWare last generation was very limiting to developers. They've fixed a lot of things with this generation, but I think some developers are still feeling the scorn from it. I definitely think they should get over it because there's money to be made. But no, nobody's blame free, but I do blame third parties more than I blame Nintendo. Let's see. Are third parties in it to destroy Nintendo? I don't think they're in it to destroy Nintendo. I definitely think they're in it to, I would say the stockholders and the people who have major stock and into Microsoft and Sony want to destroy Nintendo, and they will use means to try to do that. I think because they want Nintendo's games on Microsoft and Sony systems because they know Nintendo has a huge following. Therefore, that's more money in their pocket. So that's what the major stockholders, they want Nintendo out of the business, you know, for Sony and Microsoft. Guys like Michael Pachter, don't listen to a freaking word he says when he says, oh, I like Nintendo. No, he doesn't. He wants Nintendo to be out of this business because he wants all that money to go to Microsoft and Sony. It's a power game. It's a power struggle. So no, I don't think third parties necessarily, they don't pull enough strings. But I think even like the bigger third parties, I'm not going to name any, you know, particular, but the bigger, the really huge ones, certain ones, maybe so, because they have strong ties to these people that own these systems and stuff like that. So that's all I'll say on that. Let's see. In order to maintain a good flow of games, how often should Nintendo release first-party games? One a month or every 2 to 3 months? I think Nintendo should release at least one game every single month. And I think the way that they can do that is if they do this whole the reimagined line of games that they talked about, where basically it's like the Wind Waker HD, where they get a separate team to make a port. They can make these in 6 to 5 months time, maybe a little bit more, and they need to get maybe 2 or 3 of those people. It's cheap. 6 months of development time isn't a lot. Remake your classics in HD, add some online multiplayer, add some new content in there, like the Wind Waker HD. Put it out, and that way, in between the big releases, you have these ones. And I think that's the way that Nintendo can come back in this race. If they start bringing back those classics, that a lot of older people like. Like, if you get like a Mario 64, you know, redone in better graphics and stuff like that, I think that's gonna attract a lot of people. You get Ocarina of Time, but if you get Majora's Mask, or if you get any of these older games, F-Zero, get these games, you know, spiffed up, 1080p, 60 frames per second. Get them out there in between your big releases of Zelda, Metroid, or, you know, Shin Megami Tensei, and you'll see a lot more people hopping onto the Wii U. I think that's something they have to do. Every month there has to be at least one big game, because you can't rely on third parties anymore. Nintendo can no longer rely on third parties, except for the ones that they trust. Like, Shunin, they can rely on them. So maybe you don't release a game in that month when they come out, or whatever, you know, and they come out with their game, and you promote that. But you can't rely on Bethesda, you can't rely on EA, you can't rely on Ubisoft, you can't rely on any of these companies, because all of their games on Nintendo systems, they're sometimes gimped, they don't have all the content, so you need to provide. Nintendo needs to worry about themselves from now on. They need to worry about themselves, and they need to worry about the loyal companies, like the people who make Steam World Dig. You can rely on them. The people who make the indie developers, you can rely on those guys that are putting out content, you know, and being fair. But you cannot rely on the major third parties anymore. So Nintendo needs to worry about themselves and make sure they have content every single month. All right. Next question is from Kaylee19. What is your most nostalgic video game, and what third-party games would you like on Wii U? My most nostalgic video game is probably Super Mario Bros. 3. I just really get a lot of emotions when I start playing that game, because I played that game so much when I was a kid. Me and my brother would play that game, and we would come home from school and we'd be like, let's play Mario Bros. This weekend. Yay, no homework. Yay, Mario Bros. And that was like our life. It was playing games, hanging out, and it was the life was so simple back then. So when, you know, I get some free time, because now I'm a father, I have a family, I got lots of other responsibilities and stuff. So when I start playing that and I have some time, it really brings back memories of me and my brother, because me and my brother are real tight. We're really good friends. And it just brings back memories and nostalgia from just simpler days. but yeah, great times. And Mario Bros. 3, Super Mario Bros. 3, no doubt, most nostalgic game. Whenever I play it, I get happy, get giddy all inside. All right, and I think you have another one. What third-party games would you like to see on Wii U? I would love for there to be, you know, Bethesda's games. I would like, you know, Fallout 4, the next Fallout, which they're already teasing. I think the Pip-Boy would be Wii U controller Pip-Boy. That would be awesome. Skyrim would be awesome. I think Bioshock Infinite should have came to Wii U. That would have been really cool. What other third-party games? I would love to see Mass Effect 4 on the Wii U, but EA. I'd love to see Destiny on the Wii U, which could still probably maybe get there. Who knows? They haven't ruled it out yet. What else? I would like to see... that's all I can think of right now. Yeah, that's all I can think of as far as third party. Infamous Second Son, maybe if that was on the Wii U, that'd be cool too. so yeah, those were the games. Alright, so next question. Nobody 13. First question, what are some games on your radar for the next couple months and into 2014? Well, Donkey Kong Country Tropical Freeze, Super Mario 3D World, The Legend of Zelda: A Link Between Worlds, and that's pretty much it for this month. I have a backlog of games that I'm going to be doing for my stuff, so, but yeah, those are the three games that I'm thinking. For next year, 2014, Infamous Second Son, that's definitely on my radar, but I'm not getting a PS4 anytime soon. I'm interested in seeing how Titanfall plays out. Maybe I'll get a PC copy, but I don't think so. I'm not a big shooter guy, and it's only multiplayer. Of course, I said Donkey Kong. We'll see Mario Kart 8. That should be spring. Super Smash Bros. Shin Megami Tensei. I mean, I'm interested. There's a lot of stuff coming, so very interested in a lot of things. Kirby Triple Trouble. That's going to be out in Japan on January 11th or something like that, so maybe a couple months after for America. So I'm interested in that as well. So yeah, interested in a lot of different things. Alright, Nobody's next question. How do you think the PS4 and Xbox One launches will do? Well, we've seen it. I think they're going to do okay, but with the PS4's problems right now, and I think that's going to hurt them. That's going to hurt them quite some bit when people are trying to buy some later, because there's stock on Amazon, and I went to the store yesterday. I saw a PS4 there, so I mean there's PS4's places. And I think it's going to hurt them when they start hearing about all that. As far as Xbox One, I think Xbox One will sell out. I think the stock's going to be very small on the Xbox One. I don't think they've made a lot. It's like an expensive console. It's going to cost a lot, you know, like I said. And I think there's going to be very limited stock, so I think they are going to sell very well. But I think after that, I think after the hype and dies down, the $500 price tag is going to sink Microsoft. That is just, it's not an affordable console. Because if you think about it, you have a $500 console plus tax. You're looking at, you know, $550, whatever, $540, $550. Then you're looking at one extra controller for maybe a family member in the game to play Madden or whatever. That's $60. So right there, you have $600. You're looking at Xbox Live. That's another $60. So you're looking at $660. And then if you include a game in there, one game, you're looking at $700 out of the gate just for you to play with a buddy right next to you or to play with a family member, you know, right next to you. It is expensive. It is a ripoff, and I think it's a ripoff. And not only that, but the games, like for instance, like Rise, Forza, you know, some of the best games that they have on the system have these season passes. So even to get all of the content, you need to spend another extra $20 on top of your $60. And to add insult to injury, Forza has only 200 cars. The last Forza on the Xbox 360 had 400 cars. So they're basically charging you for content that should already be in the game. These discs are bigger. There's no excuse because the Xbox 360 disc was smaller. The Xbox One discs are 25 gigabytes. So there's no reason why there shouldn't be more cars in there. So to add insult to injury, they charge you with these season passes. They charge you for multiplayer. The games are expensive. The controller's expensive. Everything is expensive with the Xbox One. So I don't think it's going to do well after the holiday. They need a price cut and they need an overall change of mentality than trying to jip and rip off customers here and there. So yeah, that's my thoughts as far as the Xbox One. The PS4, I think the PS4 has such a strong, loyal fan base. I think they're gonna gut through this wrench, but I think it's gonna hurt them in the short term, but in the long term, if they can get these problems situated, I think it's going to be good because it is cheaper than the Xbox One and more powerful than the Wii U. All right, next. How do you think Sony not releasing the PS4 in Japan will affect sales in the long run? Well, I don't know how big of a deal it is to Sony because Sony barely sold 10 million units. I think Sony is looking at the Japanese market and saying, this isn't the future. The future is the US. So how will it hurt Sony in the long run? It'll hurt maybe just a tad bit, but not really much because some Japanese developers are just going to throw their games at Sony no matter what. Just say, here we go. Just going to throw them at Sony because they have loyalties to Sony. So Sony will get some of those Japanese sales. But in the long run, I don't think Sony thinks that Japan is a major market because look at the PS3 sales. They already got outsold by the 3DS. 3DS only been out for, you know, 2.5 years or so, and it's already been outsold. So I think Sony sees Japan as a portable market. All right, next question is from Ludwig Vask. Do you think the big online open world games like Final Fantasy 14, The Division, Destiny, and pretty much games that will have only multiplayer focused and no single player campaign like Titanfall could actually rise even more and become one of the dominant genres this next gen along with shooters? Yes, I do think so, at least with PS4 and Xbox One. Take a wild guess on the number of Super Mario 3D World Metacritic, minus 95. I'm gonna say 94, 93, one of those two. Do you see a home console Pokemon game? He thinks it will happen more along the lines of Stadium or Coliseum. I see a home console Pokemon game, but here's the thing. I think Nintendo's gonna wait and see because that is Nintendo's trump card, is a Pokemon game. I think that's the one thing that they can do. If Wii U doesn't pick up, that's the one game that they need to get into production, but it's going to take a couple of years to make. So I think Nintendo's probably initially planning some things. I think that the Pokemon company is working with the tech. You saw that one, I think it was like Blaziken and Lucario. They're working with the Wii U tech. They're understanding it. I think they're rendering some models just to make sure. And I think that if the Wii U doesn't pick up, you're definitely going to see a full-blown Pokemon game probably in the next 3 years or so. Because next 2 years, it really depends. But Nintendo, I think if they really want the Wii U to be successful, they need to convince the Pokemon company. They don't have to do this because I think they have other games like Smash Bros. That will help and stuff like that. But if things don't go as planned, I think they really need to convince the Pokemon company to make a, a full blown like Pokemon Z on the Wii U and have it interconnect with the 3DS.
And he asked for crossovers. He says, which one of these crossovers is more likely to happen? Metroid versus Star Fox, Shin Megami Tensei versus Pokemon. That's a weird one. 3D Mario cross Sonic.
3D Mario cross Sonic. That could be, I think that might be the secret game that they're working on, that Sega and Nintendo are working on, a Mario cross Sonic game. We'll see though, we will see. So that's the most likely for me then. I think that's the most likely that will happen. All right, man, these questions are humming along here. Didn't think how long it's gonna take. I'm losing my breath here. I might have to take a little break. All right, Shark Lasers asks, if the PS4 and Xbox One are unable to gain traction, do you think developers will shift their focus to established platforms such as the 7th generation consoles, Wii U, PC, or will we see more developers simply release on every platform available, much like Ubisoft is doing? Additionally, do you think an increase in multi-platform games will finally convince Sony and Microsoft to allow cross-platform multiplayer like Nintendo has? Let's see. So, shift their focus. I think they'll just focus on the 7th generation. If they don't get as much traction, I think they'll just release all of their games on the PS3, Xbox 360, and the PS4, Xbox One, and maybe Wii U will get some of those, and of course PC will get some as well. As far as, do I think they allow multi-platform, Sony and Microsoft, like, or cross-platform? No, I don't think Sony and Microsoft will allow cross-platform. Sony and Microsoft are directly in competition with each other, so I don't see them allowing cross-platform. Nintendo is just kind of like do whatever they want, so that's why I see them. They're just like, whatever, who cares, you know? So, no, I don't see that for Microsoft or Sony. Here's another question. Less importantly, do you see the possibility of developers switching their praise to Steam machines? Should the Xbox 4 or Xbox 4? Should the PS4 and Xbox One sell less than anticipated, claiming Steam machines to be a true next gen in a final attempt to ignore the inevitable plateau in graphical fidelity brought by the law of diminishing returns? I don't know if companies will praise the Steam machines. I think it depends on how well the Steam OS is. I know a lot of developers are interested in PC gaming. A lot of developers want to get that PC market because there's a lot of money to be made. If the Xbox One and PS4 don't take off and the Steam machines do, yeah, you can definitely see that. You see a lot of games already coming to Steam. So if it's coming to Steam, you know, the Steam machines, they just release their games on the Steam OS, you know? So I think so. I think PC gaming is definitely on the rise, and I think that some developers will start switching their preferences to that. It definitely could happen. And the law of diminishing returns, you're exactly right. There is a law of diminishing returns that is 100%. It doesn't matter what numbers you pull out. It doesn't matter what you say. Graphics can only get so good to the point to where it's not as, you cannot see the differences as much. Ricard Giuliani did a fantastic article a little bit ago. It says, I think it's titled, Why the Wii U Might Get More Third-Party Support Than You Think. And in there, he explains the law of diminishing returns, and he has a picture in it that perfectly describes that. So check that article out. Next question comes from X Fatal. Hey, Francis, my question is, what are your thoughts on Nintendo not having friend requests and can't post send messages on the 3DS Miiverse? How do you think Miiverse will affect online community on games such as Mario Kart and Pokemon? What do you think will benefit from the most from Miiverse, present or future titles? Let's see. So what do I think about that? I think that the reason why that Miiverse isn't getting those features as far as, and sorry for the siren noise in the background if you can hear that. I think the reason why Nintendo is, or the Miiverse isn't getting those features at the very beginning is, one is because there's still the problem with the child molestation case that's going on right now. There's still that issue. Miiverse is an open community. It's so much easier to find people and so much easier for people to post about their life or post about where they live or post about stuff like that. And Nintendo can moderate some of it, but they can't moderate everything. So the reason why you're not getting friend requests and stuff like that is because of that case that's going on right now. If Nintendo, which the 3DS is marketed heavily towards kids, if Nintendo has something like Miiverse on there, and people hear about this, parents hear about this case, that is a very damaging effect to Nintendo and could reduce sales. So that's the reason why you're not getting friend requests and you're not getting messages. Does it suck? Heck yeah, it sucks, because I was looking forward to having an easier way to communicate with all of you guys out there, because all of us, for the most part, we're all normal. You know, we're not trying to go molest kids and all that junk like that. You know, that's sickening. I don't want to do that. I mean, I got enough problems as it is. I don't want some kid in my house doing that. That's disgusting. I wouldn't even think about doing that. And I know a lot of you guys are thinking the same way I am. I would never even think about that. But at this point with Nintendo, with the 3DS, the sales momentum and how it's having and how it's selling to a lot of kids and adults, but it's selling to a lot of kids here in the US, Nintendo has to cover their own butts when it comes to this. And that's why we're not getting it. Now, that doesn't mean it's not coming in the future. I think it's something that Nintendo could easily add. I just think right now with what's going on with that case, you need to make sure that you cover yourself, because otherwise you're going to be, if this, the 3DS turns into some Fox News, oh, this device is used for child predators, that is negative press and parents will just buy their kids something else. So that's the reason why we're not getting that. I understand from Nintendo's standpoint, I'm a business guy myself, and I understand from a business standpoint, you got to do what's best for you and best for the people affected in this case right now. So that's the reason why. But as far as games like Mario Kart stuff, I think just using the basic community features are really going to enhance the gameplay, enhance stuff like that. It's going to be fun. Miiverse is a fun community. It's a good moderation, make sure everything keeps things in line. And I think it's going to really enhance games like Pokemon and really enhance games like Mario Kart and those multiplayer aspect games, just so you can say something like, hey, I got this, took out this screenshot of this, or hey, I got this new Pokemon, or hey, you know, who wants to trade for this? You can still do that. Hey, who wants to trade for this? And, you know, put up your friend code or something like that. So yeah, I definitely think that, I think it's gonna enhance things a lot. Eric Watts asks, talk about game launches and how they never live up to people's expectations. Well, I'm pretty sure he's talking about like the Wii U's game launches and the, well, it's just because, you know, with the game launch, you know, developers are crunching, developers are still making games for the previous generation plus this generation, so it's never really going to live up to people's expectations. I really feel that Nintendo had a good launch. I really feel that Nintendo had a pretty good launch with the Wii U. I think I bought 3 or 4 games, plus I bought Nano Assault, I bought New Super Mario Bros, Nintendo Land came in the package. I bought Zombie U, so I mean, I bought like 4 games out of the launch. I think there's some quality games to play. It never lives to people's standards, just because the previous generation is there. Plus, you see stuff that's coming in the next, you know, year or so. So I mean, I don't know. Some people have really tough standards, but I think for the most part, most of the launches are okay. But that's just how it is. Just the developers are crunchy; they don't have enough time to develop into these new systems. All right, next question is from Trinity, and he or she asks, is the PS4 doomed? I think the Wii U will mop before with the PS4. Do you think the PS4 sucks? Is the PS4 doomed? No, it's just in trouble right now because of the bad press that it could potentially get and the breaking of the systems. But it's not doomed because it's the cheaper of the what people say true next generation, on with the fanboys and all those people, you know, say stuff. So no, it's not doomed, because there could be a PS4 Slim, Sony could damage control the heck out of it and get these the drones to keep on buying it. So no, I don't think it's doomed, not yet, so no. Do you think the Wii U, he thinks the Wii U will mop the floor with the PS4, who knows. Do you think the PS4 sucks? No, I don't think the PS4 sucks. I just think the PS4, there's a few things that I don't like. I don't like the fact that they put the power brick inside the PS4. They should have put the power brick outside of it so it can cool down. So it can keep the system cool, because there's overheating issues. So I wish that they did that. Another thing is, I don't like to pay for online play. It almost makes me not want to buy a PS4 at all. I refuse to pay for online play when Steam and Nintendo offer similar services or online play that you can play for free. So no, I don't like the fact that the PS4, you have to pay for online play. And I will only buy a PS4 when there's at least 6 to 7 games that I want, single player focused games where I don't need any type of online multiplayer. So yeah, I think that those aspects suck about the PS4. But the PS4 in general, I don't think it's a bad system. I think Sony's first party developers suck. I'm not a huge fan of Sony's first party games. I think that they're a little too dry and they focus on graphics more than they do on gameplay. I wish that Sony would get back to how they were in the PS2 era, where they made fantastic games that really focused on core gameplay, tight controls, and mechanics, like Crash Bandicoot, Ratchet and Clank, and Sly Cooper, those franchises has basically been forgotten, sold, or whatever, you know. So that's my opinion. But no, overall, I don't think the PS4 sucks. I think the people who call the shots, and I think the people who made the system made some bad design choices, which they're paying for right now. Brandon asks, what do you think about big Japanese support on the Wii U? I think it's coming. I think it's definitely coming. There's always a slow transition to the next generation of systems for Japanese developers, you know, because they want to take the sure bet. They want to see that the install base is there before they really commit a lot of resources to something. Now, there is exceptions, like with Square Enix, you know, but for the most part, I think Namco, and I think Capcom, and I think these Japanese companies will jump on board with the Wii U. Probably by next year, you're going to start seeing more games being announced from the Wii U from Namco. I mean, Namco did do Tekken Tag. Did do the best version of Tekken Tag tournament, you know, Tekken Tag or Tekken 6, one of those. Well, I don't know. I think it's Tekken Tag, whatever. The Tekken game that's on Wii U. The best version's on Wii U. They added content. It's a good game, you know. So I think you're going to see more. Capcom had some stuff. Square Enix did do Deus Ex, but, you know, whatever. We saw Resident Evil, so it's another one from Capcom. So I think you're gonna see more. I think we'll see more. Retro Gaming Lord, what do you think the next and final Sonic exclusive will be like? I think it'll be maybe a Mario Cross Sonic, maybe a racing game. Not really sure. Maybe Sonic Adventure 3. Some people are saying for that. Not really sure. Gerbiz. Hey dude, do you ever think we'll ever see another Rogue Squadron game? Possibly. EA has the license, so I'm not sure. He says he loved it on the GameCube, would like another one. What do I think? Maybe. Who knows? EA. The Wolves Den asks, I am curious why the press doesn't support alternative tastes in gaming. It confuses me to know that in one instance, we can care about Resogun, but act as if Pikmin is irrelevant and isn't worthy. Hell, even the issue with the PS Vita where Wise and Disgaea exist but aren't even really given a fair talk. What do you think that dictates the love of certain small budget games over others? What would it take for us as consumers as well to appreciate these other titles and change the discussion? Well, this one is... It kind of comes down to like the big conglomerate, the big budget games always get the press. Now when we talk about Pikmin like versus like a Resogun, you know, I think that's more blown up by fanboys or more blown up by biased journalists more than the actual overall case. I think a lot of people care about Pikmin. Pikmin is selling very well. I'm pretty sure Pikmin's going to outsell Resogun fairly easily, believe it or not, even though Resogun's a much cheaper game. But at the same time, I think that this question is just really weird because you don't know who's just a biased troll. You don't know who's actually, you know, just for real. I mean, you can tell sometimes when people talk about it, you know, who's for real. And those are the type of people that you have to be more tuned into than the comments on the YouTube sections and certain media outlets that like to cover certain things. So I don't really think that that the people ignore Pikmin. I just think that some people, there are trolls and biased gaming journalists out there. Well, there's a lot of people who love Pikmin and give it plenty of coverage. And as far as the PS Vita goes, I think the PS Vita was just a miscalculation by Sony. That's why it's not getting press. A lot of the gaming journalism, I think a lot of the gaming people, you know, in the major gaming industry, I think they loved what the PS Vita was about because the graphics and everything. But when it came out and they realized that these games are just graphics and it's on a smaller display and I can get all these games on my PS3 with better graphics, better sound, better everything, and the PS4 is right around the corner with better graphics, better sound. Why am I going to play the same games on this small screen when I can play it on this? Whereas Nintendo has the philosophy of gameplay first. So the problem is that the PS Vita's been painted as this system that's just whatever, you know, by a lot of people. So these smaller games like Disgaea and all that don't get the publicity that they deserve. Plus, not only that, we're in the Western, you know, mindset, and the Western media controls a lot of things. So that's why these games aren't getting as much talk. But we got to do more of it. I got to do a better job, and everybody has to do a better job of talking about these smaller games, which I try to do. If you haven't checked out my PE Reviews channel, I have my BitTrip Runner. I played through some of that, so I try to do my best to talk about some of these indie games and some of these smaller games. All right, his next question is, I think that's it. Another question from The Wolves Den. What is the franchise that currently has a niche appeal but has the potential to mature and attract a larger fan base? Fire Emblem. I cannot say this enough. Fire Emblem, there's somebody in the comments section that says Persona. Fire Emblem and Persona have the biggest opportunities to become major hits. Now, Fire Emblem Awakening was the first, Fire Emblem was the first one in the franchise that ever crossed 1 million units sold. Now, once you get hit that 1 million threshold, you're kind of big time. Now, if Nintendo can harness this, and if they can just add in a couple more things, if they can bring it to consoles and make it look impressive and put the quality behind it, which I think Shin Megami Tensei Cross Fire Emblem can do, which both of those franchises can end up being bigger, I think we can see it explode and it be in the 3 million to 400 or 4 million range. I really think that, but they really need to, this next game that's from Atlas and Intelligent Systems, they really need to make sure that it's quality, really need to make sure that it's good, because Fire Emblem Awakening is on a lot of people's radars. A lot of people have purchased the game. I think it's like at 3.4 million units sold if you count in digital. So lifetime to date, by the time, like, you know, next year, this could reach 2 million units. So that's big time. So I think Fire Emblem and Persona would be a number two. All right. Master J. Barkley asks, do you think there is a current lack of 3DS software announcements for next year? Personally, I can't think of many games. Yeah, there is somewhat of a lack because Nintendo kind of blew a lot of it out, but I definitely think that there's going to be more. There's the Triple Trouble. We know we have Smash Bros. Europe is getting Mario Party. As far as that, we don't know what else is coming, but you know Nintendo has games planned. You know they have games planned for the 3DS. So, while there's a lack of announcements, I definitely think there's going to be more games coming. Next question, George asks, what are your thoughts about Miiverse on the 3DS not being able to send messages? I talked about that already. I talked about that. Next question is from Dothip. Yeah, Dothip. Two questions, actually. One, when are you going to manufacture Player Essence t-shirts so we can buy them? So I'll answer that question. So this is a question I've been getting a lot. Now that I've seen all these questions, I am going to actually put out a questionnaire. I have something that I'm going to be announcing at the end of the show, which is going to coincide with that. I'm going to be asking people if they want this. Pretty soon, you should be able, probably in December, I'm going to get a list. I'm going to ask people who would like a t-shirt. And depending on how many people said they would be able to, like, commit to buying a t-shirt or saying that, yeah, they would buy a t-shirt, you know, for the price that I can put up, that's when we'll know we'll get one. Now, are the t-shirts coming? Yes, the t-shirts are 100% coming. 100% coming. You guys are going to be able to buy a t-shirt like this or something that's very similar to this and probably this color or another color. I'm not really sure right now. So, yeah, they are coming. I just wanted to make sure that I grew my website. And it seems from all these people, it seems like a lot of people are interested. But I will be doing an official questionnaire. If you guys want these t-shirts, what would be the ideal price range for you guys and all that. And depending on the feedback that I get from that is when we'll see those t-shirts. But they are coming either December or probably next year, early next year, you'll see those. Second question. Do you think that Nintendo will bring a 3C Pokemon game, Pokemon Coliseum Stadium, next year to the Wii? Not next year, no, not next year. I'd probably say 2015 or 2016 is when they'd bring that. And yes, I do think there's going to be connectivity.